Good morning, Pastor Ken Legg from Australia, Queensland. In fact, it's evening where you are, but it's morning in the UK. Pastor Ken Legg, yeah. Give me five this morning. Lovely to see you. And we have known each other, Ken, since we were teenagers. We went to the same fellowship as well, and it's lovely to see you today, and thank you for doing this interview. Now, Pastor Ken Legg, you are the pastor of New Beginnings Christian Church in Queensland, Australia, and you're also a radio presenter. At what moment did you know you had received a call from the Lord to be a leader of men and women?
Well, I'd answer that in two ways, Jeannie. Yeah. First of all, I believe that the call of God is more of a process rather than a defining moment. It can be a defining moment, but it's basically God working in your heart, awakening the gifts that he's given to you, and directing you in that course. Yeah. Now, for me, you remember our times back in Bark in Elim, in what we call the Crusaders, the youth group, and God was working in my heart at that time. That's when it all started. And at that time, actually, I had a job delivering bread. So I used to go to people's homes and deliver bread, take the money, and you know, do them around. Yeah. And what happened? They're supposed to take about 7 or 8 hours. I used to run around and deliver the bread and get all the money and so on, and finish it in about 5 hours. Wow. And then just sit in my van and read all these wonderful books about, you know, people like D.L. Moody and Spurgeon and all the great evangelists and missionaries like Hudson Taylor. And God was moving in my heart and calling me, you know, to give my life to that kind of ministry.
Yes.
And, I would feel the Spirit of God coming upon me in that. I'd have to say that I felt this, you know, sometimes I'd be driving along and just weeping because the Spirit of God was moving in my heart. It's quite funny. One day I went to one house and delivered this bread, and a man opened the door and he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Gave me the money, took the bread and closed the door. Okay, Lord, I'm hearing you.
That's brilliant.
So that was kind of like the process. And but you remember Len McGee. Len and I, we've been good friends for over 50 years, and he's also with me on the Gold Coast. He's also on the Gold Coast. We meet together. But there was a time when we went to the Isle of Wight camp with, as a tent officer with the young people. You probably remember those days.
I remember being there.
And, we were both feeling the call of God and the stirring of God. And I remember the day when we after the kids were tucked into bed, we went to the cliff. You know, we had a blanket, a torch, and our Bible. And we both went together. Then we split up and went in different directions just to seek God. And then after about an hour or two, we came back together. And I remember Len saying to me, what's God said? I said, you know what? He's calling me into the ministry. He said, me too.
Wow.
We both felt the same night, you know, that confirmation. Now, Len went to Bible school about a year before I did. He got in quick because it was at the start of a new year. So he applied quick and got in that year. Then I followed him the year after. Now, the second part of that question, though, Jeannie, I would say this. I discovered there's a difference between the call of God and the sending.
Right.
You know, like if I call you, do I want you to come to me or go from me? Of course, I want you to come to me. But, you know, we get all excited. We just want to go through the Bible school, get a bit of paper, and off we go. You know, we're keen to get into it.
Of course.
But I realized many years later that what's important is the message. That, you know, if God is calling us, he's sending us with a message. So he wants us basically to sit at his feet and receive the message very clearly. And so that took me years later to understand that the message is all about Jesus. It's all about the finished work of Christ, what he's done for us. And that's what we minister. Like Paul said, you know, I'm determined to know nothing among you except for Jesus Christ and him crucified. So then that's when my whole ministry changed, when I understood that I need to sit at the feet of Jesus, just really soak in the message and then go with that message. And that was like a defining moment in my ministry, a turning point, if you like.
Yeah, I can see that. Tell us a bit about your radio work, because you're a radio presenter.
Yeah, well, I've got a, there's a radio station here called Vision Radio, and they have about 700 plus radio stations around the country. And I've done a year's worth of programs. So the 10-minute program's called Set Free with Ken Legg, and they're on twice a day at different times. So each year, at the end of the year, they move them to another spot to get a different audience. So that goes from Monday to Friday. So there's 250 programs, 50 weeks of the year. We've got 250 programs that are aired every year. And then I do a local program here once a month on the local community radio, and Len does the same as well on that.
So can people in the UK access this if they want to listen to your radio program?
Yeah, it's all online. It's all, like, especially Vision, if they go Vision Radio. In fact, I've just uploaded some to YouTube just before I came on here. They can even check it out on my YouTube channel. Just go Ken Legg, and then it should come up. I've got about 300 videos up there, so yeah.
That's
but brilliant. they can get the live broadcasts of what they call podcasts. Just go Vision Radio, and then it's Set Free with Ken Legg.
Brilliant. And I would suggest people who are listening to this interview today, Ken, listen to your word, because God's given you a very powerful and wonderful ministry. Now, Ken, you are the author of several books, but I'm wondering what type of books you read. Could you tell me, for instance, what book is on your bedside table at this very moment?
Okay. Look, I tend to read more, you know, I believe Christianity is organic. So I tend to read that kind of book more, you know, the organic life we have in Christ, rather than organizational. There's a lot of Christian books like the How To, Seven Steps To, Four Keys To. They don't do anything for me personally. No. They might for other people, but for me, I want to know about the life we have in Christ, because that's where it all flows from there. So I've just actually finished reading a, you'll laugh at this, it's a book that was written, I didn't realize it, I just, you know, went to the bookshop, I thought, wow, that looks good. So I picked it up and brought it home. I realized it was written by a group of ladies, four ladies. You know, it's powerful, it's called Identity Theft.
Oh,
so it looks at different aspects of our identity in Christ, and then how the devil will come and try to steal that away from us with, you know, substitute messages and so on. Very good book. So I would recommend that. It's called Identity Theft.
That sounds a good book. And so if people want to read any of your books that you have written, Ken, where can they get these from?
They can get them from my website, which is www.kenlegg.com.au. So it's kenlegg.com.au, AU for Australia. So I've written, I've got a few, just I'll quickly mention them here.
Yes,
this is
please.
The life. This is the life. Can you see that, by the way?
Yeah, that's brilliant. Oh, that looks good. This is the life.
How to establish your heart in the grace of God. Because, you know, that's one of my main things, is the grace of God.
Yeah, that's brilliant.
This one here is called New Covenant, New Glory.
Brilliant.
Because we're in a covenant with God through Jesus. But some people have still got one foot in the old covenant and one foot in the new covenant. And they wonder why Christianity is not working for them. This one here is called It's Not What You Eat That's Making You Sick, But What's Eating You.
Great title.
And it's about the fact that, you know, when we come into the Christian life, we often bring a lot of baggage in with us.
Yes.
So that book looks at how did that get there and what's God's way of dealing with it.
Wonderful.
This one here is called Grace Roots, 40 Days of Grace. So these are just very short, sharp chapters, almost like a devotional, you know, you can read a chapter a day. It's called Grace Roots.
That sounds good.
And then this one is called Grace, the Power to Reign, which is more the, you know, like a lot of people think that grace is just, you know, the old saying, grace is a license to sin. Well, it's not. It's the opposite. It's the only thing that can get us out of sin.
Agreed.
And it's the empowerment of, it's God's power working in our lives to do all that he wants to do in us and through us.
Yeah, you're right.
And then this is the last book that I wrote, Jeannie, is called Tetelestai, which is the word for it is finished. you know, the final word of Jesus on the cross. So it speaks about the finished work of Christ and what that means for us today.
And that's amazing.
So they can get that on my website. We send it anywhere in the world, and they're also available in PDF form.
Brilliant, because you know, a lot of people listening today love to read books. They're probably looking for their next book, so they've got a really good choice here to read, which is absolutely brilliant. And Christmas coming up, birthdays, you know, things like that, or just a gift for someone. It's a lovely gift to give somebody, Ken. So that's brilliant. Now, Ken, could you tell me then what value you place on your personal devotional quiet time with the Lord?
Right. My question is, does he have to be quiet?
Exactly, because you want it to be a happening time rather than a quiet time.
I used to, for many years, have like a set time, and I still do now, by the way.
Yes.
But I've come to realize that, you know, it's like we've got to be careful we don't look at certain things as holy things, holy places, holy people, holy times, holy, you know, so on. We can go on. Our whole life is holy, you know, because the veil has been rent, and we're with God. Where God is, we are, and where God is holy. So I tend to think, you know, it's not so much like a quiet time, although I do have one, I've got to say that. But it's like, you know, Jesus said, pray without ceasing. Paul said, pray without ceasing. So it's our whole life is a prayer. Life, you know, it's like through the day we're communing with God, and that's the new covenant life. It's not like we're going into the Holy of Holies, then we're coming out and, you know, going on our way. It's like God is with us all the time. But I do have a time. I have I've changed it over the years. I think everyone finds their own particular style or pattern that suits them. But I tend to have a reading in the morning. I get up fairly early. I go to bed early. In fact, you're keeping me up right now, Jeannie.
Yeah, it's quite late where you are. Sorry.
Only joking. So I tend to get up early, read the Word, have about half an hour in the Word. And then in the afternoon, I like to come back to that reading with prayer, but pray it, you know, pray prayerfully, if you know what I mean.
I do.
So that's, and it is an important thing in my life.
Yeah, I can see that. That's wonderful, Ken. And it should be important in all of our lives. I happen to know that writing a book is exceptionally hard work. Now, some people may think it's easy, but even though it's hard work, do you find it exhausting, or do you find it energizes you when you write your books?
Yeah, that's a good question, Jeannie. It's easy and hard. It's easy in the sense that I believe if you're going to write a book, it's because there's a book inside you. There's something that wants to come out. There's an overflow. And so for me, it's like I want to burst into print. I want to get it into print. So that the motivational side is not difficult. But it's a hard work. You say you also know about writing. Have you written?
I haven't, but Paul, my husband, he's written books. So I know how he's locked himself away in the office for hours on end to write books, you know.
So he knows.
He knows.
The hard part is really sort of what I would call combing it through. You're constantly combing it, refining it, polishing it. You think you're there, then you look at it, think, no, that jars, and you've got to sit down again and just keep going over it and over it to so that it flows. That's where the hard work is, I think. The actual, you know, the inspirational part of it, that comes naturally, but just getting it down, you know, you can't write the same way you speak.
No.
In the pulpit, you can, you know, you can just be down to earth and chatty sort of thing, but I think when you write a book, it needs to be orderly, and there needs to be some kind of you know, order about it
for the reader. that's true. So Ken, lastly, I have heard that you have an online Bible school. So this online Bible school, how does it actually work?
Okay, just backtrack a little bit. We have quite a big ministry in Africa,
yes,
and particularly in Zambia. We have we went there with conferences, mm-hmm, and there's a lot of wrong teaching in Africa, a lot of bad teaching that just really messes with people's minds, and it's got nothing to do actually with the gospel or the Bible even. You know, it's a lot of strange doctrines. So we found that going over there, doing their conferences, people would get help, but it was a year before we come back, and so they kind of went back into their old ways. So what we did is we set up on the ground Bible schools, schools of ministry we call them, and they're just small and very simple. We buy them a TV and give them all my teaching on USB sticks, and sometimes they need, in fact often they need, a solar set because of power cuts and so on.
Right.
And so we found that was very, very successful. So actually today we have 330 of those Bible schools in Zambia.
Amazing.
So if you say like 10 to 30 students per school, that's a lot of people that are being discipled. And so it was very effective. The last time we went there, which was last year before, you know, lockdown, of course,
yes,
we graduated over 3,000 students.
Wow.
And so one of our team said, look, you know, really we need to get this online because we can't go everywhere. So we put it online and it's free. So just to answer your question, how does it operate? People just need to go online,
yes,
and register. Once they register, they can go through. We have six phases. Each phase has 40 sessions in video with notes. You can download the notes. They're quite full notes.
Yes.
And it's really been successful because we're ministering to people all over the world. It's every part of the world you could think about. It's even places like Iceland and,
wow,
Dominican Republic and places like, how did they find us? But you know, when you're online, people do tend to find you, you know.
Yeah,
so basically, to answer the question, if people want to go online, the website address is www.onlinegracebibleschool.com. Onlinegracebibleschool.com.
Thank you, Ken. That sounds absolutely amazing, really amazing. If anybody wants to, you know, further their knowledge about the Lord,
yep,
as well, and get stuck into the Bible, this sounds wonderful, absolutely a wonderful thing to do. Ken, you have been such a joy to interview. I've so enjoyed interviewing you today.
Oh,
it's been wonderful after so long. And I can really see, Ken, the Lord is using your ministry in such a powerful and big way. You've a tremendous ministry that the Lord's given you. And Ken, thank you so much for this informative interview today. And there's only one thing left to say. Thank you. Give me five, Ken. Brilliant. Ken, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure, and God bless your ministry. We pray for you. And we pray that the Lord will continue to use you and bless your ministry. God bless you, Ken. God bless. Thank you.